So in the last lecture, we were looking at how to analyze convergence of nonlinear procedures for solving nonlinear algebraic equations, iterative procedures. And we said that in general, we could write any iterative method for solving nonlinear algebraic equations as a one equation. See, I want to solve for f of x equal to 0, x belongs to Rn, and f is a n cross 1 vector. This is a n cross 1 function vector. Any iterative method to solve this problem numerically can be written as x k plus 1 is equal to g of x k. Well, it can be so the old guess generates a new guess, and this process is continued till difference between two successive solutions become negligible or norm of f of x goes close to 0. If you look carefully, this is a nonlinear difference equation. It is a nonlinear difference equation. The index here is iteration index k. Okay, so the new guess is generated from the old guess. G is the transformation. Okay, I showed you that all the methods that we are looking at, iterative methods, can be expressed in this form. Now, just like we had conditions for analyzing linear difference equations earlier, we had looked at equations of this type is equal to b xk, and for this particular case we had derived necessary and sufficient condition for norm of xk to go to 0 as k goes to infinity, right? In this case, we had a very, very powerful result, that is, spectral radius of b is strictly less than 1 . This was the situation for the linear difference equation. We had got this kind of a generic form while analyzing iterative methods for solving linear algebraic equations. And this, we could derive a very, very powerful result here based on the eigenvalues of matrix B. Okay, we wanted all eigenvalues of matrix B to be inside the unit circle. Okay. Now, coming to nonlinear equations, it is not possible to prove a so strong result. We can only give sufficient conditions. It's not possible to come up with necessary and sufficient conditions for a general nonlinear difference equation of that form. We have to come up with some kind of local condition. So these local conditions I described through contraction mapping theorem. Or contraction mapping principle, which forms the foundation of analyzing iterative schemes. And one special lemma that we saw was the operator G, or which maps, so G is something, G maps a unit, not a unit ball, a ball around x naught of radius r to where r was a special radius which should be greater than or equal to a certain number that we had defined yesterday. So if G is a mapping which maps a ball of radius r into itself, then, and if G is a contraction map, so one simple way of finding out whether G is contraction map over U was to see whether dou G by dou X was strictly less than 1 or less than or equal to theta, which is less than 1 for all X in if the partial derivative of G with respect to X has a norm, any induced norm, strictly less than 1 everywhere, then we know that map G is a contraction. If map G is a contraction, then in neighborhood of X naught of radius r, we were assured of existence of a solution. We are assured that any sequence starting from any point in this region would converge to the solution. So solution of this problem is X star is equal to G of X star. X star is the solution, and if this condition is met everywhere in this ball, then it's a sufficient condition to say that any sequence generated by this difference equation will converge to this solution. Solution is X star is equal to G of X star. Just to draw the parallel, I'm writing this just to draw a parallel. We had a sufficient condition here that if norm of B is strictly less than 1, if norm of B is strictly less than 1, then also this condition holds, that is xk goes to 0 as k goes to infinity. Norm xk goes to 0 as k goes to infinity. So we said this is a weaker condition than this necessary and sufficient condition, but this condition helped us, right, to analyze, to come up with diagonal dominance and all kinds of other things, which were other theorems which were used to analyze iterative schemes. Likewise, analogous to this, when I come here, this contraction mapping principle tells us very, very important things. One is that if G is a contraction map, G is a contraction map if its local derivative has, see, if you take G of X, if you take G of X to be BX, then local derivative of G with respect to X will be matrix B. And any induced norm of matrix B being strictly less than 1 is the condition that we are looking for there. So they coincide. And then this particular equation, well, only difference there was the solution, or the point where we wanted to reach was 0, 0, 0, origin. In this case, we want to reach a solution X star is equal to G of X star. It's possible to make everything in terms of 0, 0, 0. If you redefine, or if you shift the origin to X star, then you can make the two problems almost equivalent. But that is not so important. It's just a matter of shifting the origin. What is important is that there's a analogous sufficient condition here for nonlinear difference equations. it doesn't help us here to look at the spectral radius of this matrix. It doesn't help here for the reasons which are difficult to explain as a part of this course, but we have to use only norm. And the norm, if the induced norm, if any induced norm is strictly less than 1 in some region, then you are guaranteed that there exists a solution to this difference equation in that region. Okay, the solution is unique. And the third point, which was very, very important, start from any initial guess, you will converge to that solution. Okay, start from any initial guess in that region, you will converge to the solution x star is equal to g of x star. So these are very, very important findings of this particular theorem. In general, it is more difficult to apply this theorem for a complex real problem. Nevertheless, it gives us some insights. Okay, it gives us insights. For example, we can try and make the sufficient conditions meet by ensuring that dou g by dou x has, you know, induced norm less than 1. We can try to do this if there is some problem in some solving some nonlinear algebraic equations. We can see these are sufficient conditions. Remember that. If these conditions are violated, even then the convergence can occur. These are not necessary conditions. But if this happens, convergence will occur. Just like in this case, when we are talking about linear algebraic equations, okay, if norm of B is less than 1, spectral radius is less than 1, it's a sufficient condition. But if norm of B is greater than 1, even then convergence can occur, because convergence depends upon the spectral radius. Spectral radius can be less than 1. Okay. Similarly, contraction mapping principle gives us a sufficient condition for convergence. Okay. It is not a necessary condition. But if you meet the sufficient condition, you are guaranteed to converge. Okay. So this gives at least some handle to understand how the convergence occurs. Okay. From that viewpoint, this is important. So those of you who are solving large set of algebraic equations as a part of your research, MTech or PhD, and hit into problems, you should look at the norm of the Jacobian. I mean, at least that much you should remember. Look at the norm of the Jacobian. Okay? That will give you some, try to tweak, try to see whether you can make the norm of the Jacobian less than 1. Then, you know, you have good chances of convergence. Just to illustrate this idea of contraction map, I'll just give you one example here. I want to solve simultaneously z plus these are two nonlinear algebraic equations which I want to solve simultaneously. Okay, so if I write this minus this equal to 0 and this minus this equal to 0, then this is f of x equal to 0. Okay, there are two functions, f1 zy and f2 zy. I want to find out a solution for this particular problem. Well, I'm formulating an iteration scheme here, z k plus 1 is equal to 1 by 16 minus 1 by 4 y k square, and I have just formed one iteration scheme. This is not the only way to form iteration scheme. I am just showing you one possible way of forming the iteration scheme. Okay? So, this is a Jacobi type iteration scheme. what would be the Gauss seidel kind of iteration scheme? If I were to use zk plus 1 here, it will become Gauss seidel type iteration scheme. This is a Jacobi type iteration scheme. Okay. Now what I'm going to do here is, so I have this scheme which is y z is equal to g of y z, okay, where g is this right hand side function, okay, and then I am considering this unit ball. I am considering unit ball let's say my x naught, my initial guess is 0 1 and no 1 minute, my my initial guess is x0 is equal to 0, 0, okay, and I am considering this unit ball of radius 1 in the neighborhood of 0, 0. So, I am looking at, okay. Now what is what is this infinite norm g of, I am taking some point xi and some point xj. Okay, x here is, x consists of y and z. Okay, x is the vector, consists of two elements, y and z. Now, I'm looking at this. Well, what is the norm? What is the infinite norm? Infinite norm is maximum of the absolute value of the two elements, right? See, what I'm doing is I'm taking g xi minus g xj. Okay, it has two elements. Okay, I'm just taking the maximum of these two absolute values will be the norm. I'm just using definition of infinite norm. Okay, nothing else. This is just definition of infinite norm. So you can show that this is less than or equal to max of, I am skipping in between steps, you should fill them up. just go back and look at why this step comes from this. You can prove these inequalities, that is, this particular difference is infinite norm of this difference is less than xi minus xj, half times xi minus xj. So actually the contraction constant is half. See, I just wanted to show that in this particular case you can show, for this particular case you can show that, well, I am using here the fact that the elements are drawn from the unit ball, okay, elements are drawn from the unit ball, so that's why this steps have been written. And essentially using this inequalities, what you can show is that gi minus gj okay, using these inequalities, you can also do analysis using the derivative of this and taking its infinite norm. You can also do analysis using derivative of this right hand side, Jacobian matrix and infinite norm of the Jacobian matrix. That analysis is also possible. In this particular case, we have found that if you apply G, okay, on any xi and xj, then this inequality holds. If this inequality holds, okay, what it means is that, see, this constant on the right hand side is less than 1, okay, so this is strictly less than 1, so this G map is a contraction. If G map is a contraction, I am guaranteed that there exists a solution in this unit ball, okay, the solution is unique, okay. And starting anywhere in this unit ball, this is with reference to the infinite norm, so it will be a square, it will look like a square. We have seen this, how does a unit ball look like in different norms. So starting from any initial guess within this, the iterations will converge to the solution, okay. So this we are guaranteed because we are able to prove this inequality here, okay, for this particular x is equal to g of x, okay. So what is important here is that just looking at or just developing this inequality, this is infinite and infinite norm, just developing this inequality, I am guaranteed that a solution exists in the ball, I am guaranteed that I start from anywhere and I will reach the solution, okay, I reach the solution, and so this iteration scheme is going to work. That's what I know from this analysis. Okay, just right now, just don't bother about this in between steps. Assume that this sequence is true because our aim is not to do this algebra. Okay, you can work on this algebra later. More important is that by doing this algebra, I can show that infinite norm, okay, of gi minus gj divided by xi minus xj. So for any ij, I can prove this. So I take any two points in this ball, apply g on both the points, the new points will have a distance which is closer than the original two points. That is the main thing. If that happens, okay, we are assured that a solution exists. Okay, we are assured that starting from x naught will reach the solution. Moreover, from any initial guess in this region, if we start, we'll still reach the solution. Okay, that is the important point. Okay, it's difficult to do this analysis for a very large scale nonlinear system. Nevertheless, it is important to get this insight that how does one look at analysis of convergence of iterative schemes for solving nonlinear algebraic equations, because most of the times you'll be actually dealing with nonlinear algebraic equations large scale. okay, in your work, computational work, because most of the chemical engineering problems, 99.99% of them are nonlinear problems. Reactions occur, heat transfer occurs, then turbulence and all these things will make the life very, very complex. We have to work with set of nonlinear algebraic equations. What is it that governs the convergence? Okay, we can get some clues if you look at if you can show that the iteration scheme that you have formed actually is a contraction map. Difficult to show in general for a large scale system, but this does give you insight, which is very, very important. That's what you should carry. Okay, I want to stop here. I don't want to get into too much details. In the notes, I have given some more detailed discussion on Newton's method. So there are special theorems for convergence of Newton's method, and more than the proof and the theorem statement, I have tried to give some qualitative insights as to how to interpret those theorems. Okay, just go, and I have not included the proof. The proof can be found in any of the textbooks on nonlinear systems, like Reinhardt and Ortega is one of the very well known textbooks. So you can find proofs there, but the interpretation is quite important as to how do you make convergence occur. So typically, if you have formed a iteration scheme, well, in this case, I didn't take a derivative, but you could also try to see for this particular system. You can work this out. You can try to see whether dou g by dou x infinite norm, if this is strictly less than 1 in the region of your in the region where you are trying to operate or trying to solve the problem, or dou g by dou x 1 norm is strictly less than 1. Okay, if these conditions are met, okay, then we are guaranteed that the solution exists, and we will reach the solution. Okay, so these are why infinite norm and why 1 norm? Because they are easy to compute. Infinite norm and 1 norm are easy to compute. Okay, other norms, like 2 norms, will require eigenvalue computation. Other than that, 1 norm and infinite norm are easy to compute. So you can quickly make a judgment what is going wrong when you are solving the problem. Okay, so this brings us to an end of methods for solving nonlinear algebraic equations. We have looked at different concepts. We have looked at how to solve them using different algorithms. We just briefly touched upon idea of condition number, and also we very, very briefly touched upon the idea of convergence of iterative schemes. We haven't gone deep into it, but at least you know about, you know, what is the tool or what is the, you know, machinery that is used for actually looking at this problem. Let's move on to solving ordinary differential equations, initial value problem. So now what I want to do next is, before I proceed, again we go back to our global diagram. Okay, so our global diagram was so we have this original problem, then we use approximation theory to come up with transform problem. So we have been calling it transformed computable forms. And then we said there are four tools. One is AX equal to 0. So this tool set we have, which we'll be using. And the other tool set was f of x equal to 0. So solving nonlinear algebraic equations, solving linear algebraic equations, this is the second tool set that we have. The third tool set that I'm going to look at is ODE IVP, because in many cases the transform problem is an ODE initial value problem. Okay, even the I'll talk about a method later on. How do you transform a boundary value problem into initial value problem? Actually, not just one initial value problem, a series of initial value problems which are then solved iteratively. And the fourth tool is stochastic methods, but we are not going to get into this. So right now we have done this, how to solve AX equal to B. We looked at very many methods. We looked at many issues that are associated with this. We have looked at f of x equal to 0, and now I am moving to ODE IVP. All this, after all, is going to give us approximate solution. Okay, this is going to give us an approximate solution to the original problem. So moving on to solving ordinary differential equations, initial value problem. Okay. So general form of this, the types of equation that I'm going to look at is of this type, dx by dt is equal to f of x t. Okay, where f is the function vector and x belongs to Rn. Okay, what I'm given is, apart from this differential equation model, I'm also given initial condition. I'm given initial condition at time equal to 0. Now, before I move on, let me explain one notational difference that we will have. In this case, if we are dealing with vectors, we'll have to deal with three different attached indices with the vector. So suppose x is my vector. Okay, here ith element of the vector will be given by xi. Okay, this notation we have been using even earlier. Bracket k will indicate kth iteration. Okay, now additional complexity comes in. We have time. So time will come here. So there are three things attached to the vector. In some cases, you will have ith component of the vector. Okay, you will have time t appearing here. Okay, and you may have kth iteration. In some cases, we don't need I and k, we just might work with xt. Xt means vector x at time t. Okay, vector x at time t. So now a third dimension comes into picture here when you write in the notation. Okay, sometimes there are schemes which are iterative and you need index. sometimes you need to refer to ith component, so you need xi, and t is time. Okay. Now, what kind of equations I am worried about? What kind of equations that I am going to look at? You might say that, well, what is written here is only a first order vector matrix equation, right? Dx by dt is equal to f of x. I am writing only a first order equation, only first order derivatives. And in your engineering problems, you have often come across models which are second order, third order, fourth order. And then when you did your first course in the differential equations, you had nth order differential equations, right? And then you had methods of solving nth order differential equation. So why am I doing things only for the first order differential equation? Though the difference here is a vector differential equation. Earlier you were looking at scalar differential equation. What I am going to show that any nth order differential equation can be converted into n first order differential equations. Okay. So this form which I have written here is very, very generic. Very, very generic. Okay. So let's begin by looking at this conversion. So let's say you have this let's say I have this differential equation in the scalar variable y. So y is a scalar. Okay. Y is some mass fraction, or y is some temperature, or whatever. Whatever is the case. You have some differential equation. Let's say this is nth order differential equation. In general, a nonlinear differential equation. We do not know. I am just writing a generic form. Could be anything. This is in one variable, and independent variable is time. Okay. So what I'm going to do now, I'm going to define new state variables. Okay. So my first state variable, and well, what I'm given together here to solve this problem, it's an initial value problem. So what do I need to solve this problem? I need a differential equation and I need the initial conditions. Initial conditions are given for y0 dy by dt at 0 . So we are given initial condition, we are given initial y0, initial derivatives up to order n minus 1. These are required to solve this differential equation. With this differential equation together with this initial condition will be initial value problem, right? Solving ordinary differential equation, initial value problem. This is what I get. Okay. Now, what I'm going to do now is, to start defining a new set of variables. Okay. So my new variable x1t is equal to yt. Okay. X2t is equal to dy by dt. Okay. X3t is equal to d2y by dt square up to xnt is equal to dn minus 1 y by dt n minus 1th derivative. I am defining new variables x1 to xn. Okay. Now, you can see that these variables are related through first order differential equations. Okay, I can very easily say that dx1 by dt is equal to x2, right? Dx2 by dt is equal to x3, right? So I have such n minus 1 equations. So this is my equation number 1, equation number 2, and this is my equation number n minus 1. I have n minus such one relationships between the variables. Okay, all of them are first order differential equations. Okay, the last one is now just the equation that we have. Okay, so the last equation, nth equation, okay, this is dxn by dt. Dxn by dt is, this is nothing but d by dt of dn minus 1 y by, right? This is my definition. This is my definition. Okay. This is equal to f x1, x2, xn, t. I have an nth order differential equation which got converted into n first order differential equations. This is my first equation, second equation, n minus 1th equation, and the last equation came from the original nth order differential equation. Okay, x1, x2, x3, xn are the new state variables that we have defined. Okay, so what I have actually done is a scalar nth order differential equation I have converted into n first order differential equations in new variables. Okay, so if I have nth order equation, I can convert it into n first order equations. Okay, if I have two simultaneous equations, one nth order in one variable, other mth order in another variable, first one will give me n first order equations. Okay, second will give me m first order equations. You can stack them together into a bigger vector, you will still get this form. So this is a very, very generic form. I am not doing any compromise. Any nth order equation or any set of nth order equations, nth, mth order equations, can be combined into finally this form. This is a very, very generic form. So don't worry about why are we looking at only first order vector differential equation. Okay, so all the books on advanced books on nonlinear differential equations will worry only about this generic form, because anything can be converted to this generic form. That is the first thing to understand. So all the methods that we will develop are for this. If you have nth order equations, okay, you know how to convert them. Okay, you know how to convert them into n first order equations and write it like this. So what will be f of, in this particular case, what will be the f vector? Let's go back and write that. See, in this particular case, my f vector after the transformation, actually my equations are d by dt of x1, x2, x3, xn is equal to x2, x3, xn, okay, and f x1, x2, xn, t. this is my f of x. This is my f of x. Okay? This is the transform problem. This is my f of x. And I am given the initial condition. Okay? So I am given initial condition x naught, which is whatever. This is y0 dy0 by dt. All these are given to me, right? This is my x naught. This is my x naught. This is given to me. Okay? This is my f of x. This is my f of x. The original equation will appear as one scalar nonlinear function in your function vector. This is my function vector. Okay? And this is the transform problem. So I don't have to worry about nth order equations. I am not going to do separate methods. See, in the first course on differential equation, you have second order differential equations, one chapter on second order differential equations. Then you look at, you know, nth order equations. We are not going to separate. We are just going to look at n differential equations which are coupled. Okay. If you are trying to solve dynamic simulation of a chemical plant, there will be thousands of differential equations which are solved simultaneously together. Okay. In fact, they might be differential and algebraic equations, not differential equations. So we are worried about right now to begin with solving large number of differential equations simultaneously together in one shot. That's my aim. Okay. And this form is very, very generic, applicable to any set of other way of getting these kind of equations. We have already seen, where do you get these kind of equations? In problem discretization, where did we find them? Finite difference method, orthogonal collocations of partial differential equations that involve time and space. We discretized in space, we got differential equation in time. We got n differential equations. They were first order. Okay. So if those are of second order, you can convert them into first, you know, two first order equations. All that is possible. That's not difficult. So converting nth order equation into first order equations is not a problem. We are going to look at the generic form. This could be arising from any of the sources. It could be arising from the one which you have done right now. It could be arising from discretization of a PDE. Okay. It might be arising from some other context. The context is already, you know, we already have studied about in what context this kind of problems will come. We will look at only how to solve this abstract form, okay, of vector differential equation. The other thing which you might worry about is that where does this time t come into picture? Okay, most of the times the differential equations that you get, as an exercise, I have given you to solve differential equations for one particular system, and I have given you a program which solves differential equations for a CSTR. Okay, I suppose you remember to submit assignment soon. That equation is of this form: dx by dt is equal to f of x u. There are some free variables. X are dependent variables, and there are some free variables, okay, like feed flow, coolant temperature, inlet concentration. All these are this u variables. So in that particular problem, CSTR problem, x corresponds to concentration of A and temperature, and u corresponds to inlet flow rate, cooling water flow rate, inlet concentration, cooling water temperature at inlet, and so on. So these are the free variables. But if you go back and look at the problem statement, these manipulated variables or input variables have been defined as a function of time. Say this is sinusoidal, this is whatever. We have defined these as some functions of time. Okay. Once these are given as functions of time, we can substitute them here, okay, as some function of time, and then once these are specified, Once these are specified functions of time, then only we can solve the initial value problem. And for that particular, for those specified functions of time, this problem is then transformed to dx by dt is equal to f of x t, because u will be function of only time, some specified function of time. Okay, a ramp function, step function, sinusoidal function, or whatever, random function, whatever you want to study the dynamic dynamics of the particular system for. So you have specified these free inputs, and then this becomes a problem, which again is this generic form. Okay, so these parameters or these input variables, we assume that we already know them. Okay, and then we want to solve the problem for the known inputs. How does the dynamics evolves in time? That's what we want to solve. Okay, so that's why we are looking at, in general, dx by dt is equal to f of x t. Okay, how this is specified as a function of time? How these are specified, or how these are specified as a function of time? Let's not worry about that right now. It could be an operator who is giving this values. It could be a controller which is finding out these values. It could be some environmental conditions which define the inlet, cooling water inlet temperature. Okay, we don't bother about that right now. We want to solve a problem. When this is specified, how do you actually find out, how do you find out x as a function of time? So I want to find out, given these input trajectories in time, I want to find out x trajectory, that is concentration trajectory starting from time 0 to whatever final time you want, and temperature trajectory as solution of this problem is going to be not one vector. See, when you are solving nonlinear algebraic equations, you got one vector as a solution, the fixed point, right? Now the solution is going to be a trajectory in time. Okay, it's going to be a trajectory in time. Trajectory in time over the finite time, if you are solving over finite time, or whatever, t goes to infinity if you want to look at. Now linear equations, linear differential equations of this type, you probably have already looked at in some other course. Wherever we need them, we'll visit them. While those of you who have not done the other course on analytical methods in chemical engineering, I will just briefly mention those results which we need here. But we are going to look at the problem when this f of x on the right hand side is non-linear, not when it is linear. Okay, that's very, very crucial. We will use the results for linear later on to get some insights into the convergence properties. Under what conditions the methods that you have proposed will converge? That's where we'll use some linear system results. But in general, what we are going to look at is methods for solving nonlinear ordinary differential equations given initial conditions. How do you get trajectories in time, or it could be trajectories in space? Okay, we have seen that, for example, method of lines for, you know, converting Laplace equation. It, you discretize only in one spatial direction, the other one is treated as a differential equation. So you get a set of differential equations in time or space. So you want to integrate these differential equations. So t here, in general, need not be time alone. T here, treat it as independent variable. In some context, it could be space. So maybe I should write a generic form that neta. So neta is some independent variable. Okay, it could be time and space depending upon the context. And initial condition at neta equal to 0 is given. Okay, and you want to integrate this set of differential equations. The way we are going to proceed is we'll briefly peek into the issue of existence of solution very, very briefly, and then move on to the different methods of doing numerical integration. Okay. Again, what's going to help us is Taylor series approximation and polynomial approximations. Okay, so we are going to meet our old friends Taylor and Weierstrass again and use them repeatedly to solve these problems. Okay. What I want to stress here is that the same ideas are used again and again to form the solution methods. Okay. There are few fundamental ideas which, if you understand those ideas and if you know how to apply them, you can almost do everything from scratch. Okay. Same idea is repeatedly used. If you get this viewpoint, then you know, I think you have learned a lot in this course. So next class onwards, we'll begin with how to solve ordinary differential equations and algorithms, and then finally we'll move on to the convergence properties, under what conditions these converge, try to get some insights into relative behavior of different methods and so on.